Greetings, and welcome to The Thirsty Mage, the podcast that's yet to synthesize the perfect brew. I'm your host, expert barrel identifier, Paige Chamberlain, and this week at the pub is Ladies' Night as we take turns leveling our alchemy in Atelier Sophie 2. Joining me tonight is someone who got their entry due to their Trails fan pass, that is Maggie Jones-Lutey.
Hi, thank you for having me. It's great to be back.
Oh, so you've been on before?
Yeah, just one other time, David and I talked about Trails, so the introduction was definitely accurate.
Of course. Yeah, so we're talking about Atelier Sophie 2, which is the latest in the long-running series that is this year's release, because it's usually a yearly entry. So what other Atelier games have you played?
So I've only played one other Atelier game. I kind of got into the series recently, last year. I played Atelier Ryza 2. So I know that's probably not like the best entry point for someone just getting into the series, but I had a lot of fun with Ryza 2. And yeah, after I saw that Sophie 2 was coming out, I wanted to check that one out too.
So it's not your first time starting with one of these direct sequels to the character's entry.
Right, yeah. But the good thing is, I think, like, with Ryza 2 and with Sophie 2, it wasn't too hard to jump in, even though they were a sequel. Yeah.
I've played both Ryza games, so I knew about, like, you know, every time someone's referenced, I knew who they were. But I found that, because in Ryza there was, like, a new character, Patty, so a lot of times things would be explained to her, or you had the perspective of a new person to be like, well, I don't know what you're talking about. So you didn't miss out on too much. And then with Sophie 2, I have only played a little bit of Sophie because the way the leveling in that works is weird. Because, like, the max level was like 20 or something like that.
You know,
I was struggling with, like, which enemies am I supposed to fight, because this is too hard and this is too easy. But I knew some of the characters, so when I was playing through this game, you know, she'd talk about some of her friends, and I'd know what who some of them were, and other things I wouldn't know. But that's usually more in those extra cut scenes you get. And in Atelier Sophie 2, you have an option in, like, the main menu, you get, like, a little recap of the gist of the story from her first game, because this one is set pretty much just after that.
Right. I thought that, like, story so far movie that you can watch was really helpful. Because I even think when they first announced Sophie 2, which I guess maybe was last year, they mentioned that it would be, like, an okay starting point for someone, like, if they hadn't played the first Sophie game or other ones. And so I'm glad they had that in there, because it really made it easy to just kind of, like, jump into the story of the sequel and think, like, oh, this is where they are. They're going to take the alchemy licensing exam, and you just kind of felt like you were caught up.
Although I feel like a lot of game devs say that every game is a perfect entry point, even if it definitely is not. But
yeah.
but I think both Ryza 2 and Sophie 2 are fine starting points, actually.
Yeah, it's not like it's a game that the story is, like, a huge, huge part, and you're going to be totally lost if you don't play the first game, so, yeah.
Well, that's, they're always making new friends, so there's always other people that need to be caught up on the history.
Right, you can join them as the player.
So in this, every entry, they usually change up the different gameplay mechanics, because the games do have, like, this a general same formula, is that it's an RPG, so you have battles, but you're also, the main focus is on alchemy, so you gather the materials from battling and just finding them out in the open world, or not, semi-open, the open areas, and then taking them back to your atelier where you synthesize it. But often all these systems are different between games, or at least between the trilogies, which is how these games normally come out, where it's sort of three in a row under a subline, and then the protagonist will be different, but you might see some characters from the other two games as cameos or party members. So the fact that they've been doing the number twos is interesting.
Yeah, and I think they realize that people have really liked Sophie and Ryza, so they want to continue their story in different ways. Because I know with Sophie, she was in more than just the first Sophie game, but Sophie 2 kind of takes place in the middle of the Mysterious Trilogy games. So it's kind of cool that you get to see her in this new like part of her life that wasn't explored previously.
And actually, I think that I haven't played Atelier Lelua, but I think that's like a fourth entry in a series where the character is like the daughter of one of the other protagonists. So yeah, it's not the first few times that they wanted to go back and explore the... Because generally they're sort of their own world that I know of. There's like one character that seems to show up in almost every game, but generally, like, those settings, like, say, the stuff from the Dusk Trilogy or the world in Ryza, nothing from that has interacted from the other series, as far as I'm aware. So they're just, you know, as far as I'm concerned, they're kind of their own world. Like, maybe they're connected, but they don't bother to, you know, don't let that be a focus anyway. Like, don't distract it. Worry about, like, trying to connect all of those would be a lot.
Oh, yeah. Like, they try to keep them contained into their own setting. But I bet someone has made, like, a web graphic of some kind showing how they're all connected. I'd love to see that, because the more that I learn about the series, the more I learn that, like, there are all these little connections. So it's cool that they kind of have a little way to tie them together.
But, yeah, they're definitely obviously interested in sometimes going back to those worlds. But yeah, so in this entry, the new, like, so in Ryza 2, the new mechanic for exploration was like the dungeoneering, where you would find different pieces of information and then that would unlock the path forward for you. And then instead of that, they've gotten rid of that for now, which, you know, they probably want to save it for if Ryza's getting another game. And again, like, they change things a lot. They don't want to keep it exactly the same because it's a series that comes out almost every year. So they added a new exploration mechanic in this one, which is the weather change system. And basically that's the... In this century, I found that, like, the dungeons and the, like, the whole overworld is basically the same thing. It's just a different setting when you go into a dungeon. Like, maybe there's a couple more puzzles, but that's about it. Because this weather change system where you plonk the rock and then suddenly it's raining, so now the river is up and you can cross the river because there's some like floating stones or something, whereas before if it was sunny and you can change it back, you'd be able to walk in the riverbed and collect stuff there. I feel like that's pretty much what all the puzzles are based on.
Yeah, I thought that was a pretty cool mechanic, because as you go through the game you'd start to get more and more of the different items that could change the weather, and some of them would require like a pretty specific pattern of weather changes to get through. I think I remember like in one of the like the snowy areas where you were able to change the weather to snow, you'd have to try to get to the right point to make it rain and then make it snow so that the water would freeze so you could access a new area. But I thought that was fun. It was a bit different from what, you know, Ryza 2 had, but I appreciated just being able to kind of get to think through those puzzles. And also the worlds were just like so pretty as you explored them too. And you would get to fight different enemies when you changed the weather. So overall, I thought it was just kind of a fun way to introduce puzzles. How did you feel about it?
Yeah, I think it was a good way of ensuring maximum use of the space, because like I said, different enemies will appear in the different weather conditions you put in, different gathering ingredients will appear, so that way, and then, you know, you're not necessarily having to leave an entire area to find what you need as well. But I think the snow area is probably the most complicated the puzzles got, because it was like the three different things where you wanted the water to flow up to an exact point. So I'm not much of a puzzle fan, but nothing was too hard for me to, like, explore the area. And, I do think it was just very clever the way they used that. And like you said, the world I don't think I can actually pronounce it out loud, but it was like Erdweege or something.
Erdweege, I think.
Yeah. It's very, very pretty. And then you get to see like this area, and then some of this area with snow, or the forest area being soaked with rain, and then you're all wet, and like it's really good to just, especially for photo mode, you know, you can really set the the mood you want.
Oh yes, the photo mode was so fun. I had to like stop myself because yeah. It was just, you could just spend hours doing it, like making the characters have their own little poses and lining them up and getting them just right in the frame. It's just fun. I think it was a cool thing to include, obviously, because you could have all those like pretty sun rays just kind of like go throughout the image. Anyway, I was a little too obsessed with that, which is probably why I had so much time in this game when I played it.
I found that was a problem the last entry I played. I definitely used the photo mode. This one I was a bit more sparing because I wanted to finish the game. But I do like that because the photo mode was something they'd add to games later, whereas for this entry they're like, you know, photo mode straight away. Don't, you know, here you go. You don't have to wait for an update. In terms of, I guess, missing features, even though it's, like, again, I know why, because certain mechanics stay within, like, the sub-series, or they want to be associated with the protagonist, but I definitely missed swimming. I think because of the weather change system is why they didn't include swimming.
Yeah, that's a good thought. That part was really cool in Ryza 2, especially because the environments were so pretty, and that just gave you, like, another way to see it all. So, yeah, that would have been great to add.
Yeah, so that was, like, a little disappointing, but, yeah, I know why they've changed that. I am slightly more annoyed. One of the things in Ryza 2 was also the mount. I'm like, there's no mounts either. And I'm like, the fast travel is pretty good in this game because you can go to multiple points on a map when you've unlocked it. But I was just kind of like, I just wish I had my giant, I think it was a carbuncle or something, and you just like scare off half the enemies out of your way.
Oh, yeah. It came so in handy. Yeah. Like when you just didn't want to fight any more enemies. Yeah, I missed that. I had forgotten that Ryza 2 had the mount, but like that was so helpful.
Yeah.
Yeah. Definitely.
I know why they didn't keep some of these things, but I definitely missed them. But in terms of they've continued the multiple tool type thing where on the same spot you might use a hammer or a pickaxe, they haven't actually. In this one, it's different. You don't switch. This one, it automatically switches between tools for you, so you don't have like a spot that could have two different things unless you change the weather. That's that's when it's different. So in this one, you don't have to manually switch between your tools to grab the right one for what you want. It'll just automatically default to the scythe or the hammer. But they did add the major gathering thing. So at certain glowy spots, you do like a little mini game to try and get more money, elements, quantity, quality to it. So they're all kind of similar, but a bit. I think the fishing was the hardest out of that, really. The rest are pretty basic. It's like a roulette wheel and you stop it at the bit you want, or there's like the slingshot, the bug catching one. That one was the easiest because you could just keep tapping it. You wouldn't run out of tries like the other two.
Yeah, I liked those the most. I just like just button mashed, I guess, that whole time.
Yeah.
Those were kind of hit or miss for me. I mean, I've realized they were just kind of maybe adding something in to make exploring, just to have another little element there. But yeah. I thought they were fine, but they weren't, like, really amazing.
I think my issue was later on, I'd get ingredients and then they would just have too many elements. Like, they're just too big of a section, and I'm like, no, I think I just want, but, you know, it's better quality, but I'm like, I think I want the smaller item.
Yeah. After a while, your panel gets full and you're like, I need to fit more in here and I can't. Yeah. It's a total struggle.
Like, dropping, because in this it's back to the Mysterious Trilogy way, which is like a grid system. So it's like a puzzle when you're synthesizing in alchemy. And so in the later point of the game, I'm dropping ones that are just a sacrifice. Like they're just going to just to get out the way because I want to fit in the actual pieces that I want. And when you overlap them, they just go away. So that was, I much prefer the Alchemy of the Riser series, but that's me being not much of a puzzle fan. I still didn't find it was too difficult. Like I was able to, you know, like I said, gradually just go like, oh, this is just like a fill-in piece, or I was able to create like good enough equipment, and especially I think there was like some bosses I got stuck at, and I just came back, built a massive Draco bomb, and they were like gone basically. So, and then they actually do, yeah. So what did you think of this going? Because this is like a completely different system for you for the first time.
Yeah, I really liked it actually. And I didn't expect to get so into it, but there was a few times, well, it was more than a few actually, there were many times where I would just start synthesizing stuff and like 45 minutes would pass and I'm like, oh, I need to start doing something else in this game. Like, why am I getting so sucked into this? And so, yeah, I really liked the puzzle aspect of it. It was just fun to try to figure out like, okay, these are the shapes that I need to put here and here so that my panel can fill up. But I also want to link the glowing parts together so that the element will increase. And so I enjoyed it. Probably a little too much because I could have like been more efficient with my time in the game. But I liked it. I think the only part that kind of frustrated me was the recipe system. Yeah, because there would be things that I would gather, like ingredients that you would need to gather to unlock a recipe, but sometimes it wouldn't register, so I'd have to go out and find something again or fight this monster again, and I just felt like that kind of got tedious after a while. But the alchemy part of it was fun. It was just, in order to get this new recipe, you'd have to kind of jump through all these hoops, so... That's kind of where I stand on it. But I thought the puzzle part was really fun.
Oh, right. And then one other thing I missed from the way Riser was that you could, like, just loop into the next item. So it's more just saving you the trouble of having to go back, you know, make this item to turn it into this item to turn it into, like, it would just, like, follow through if you went a certain way. So I missed that, definitely.
Me too, because yeah, you would, and that's probably why I got, like, I spent so much time in there, because I'm like, okay, to make this bomb, I've got to make this item, and then I've got to make this item, and you have to backtrack so much just to get the recipe that you need specifically, so yeah.
And I also, because in this Riser and Plactor, the pack that you find in this world, they both synthesize, and so some recipes will be exclusive to them. And I didn't... It wasn't that annoying, but it also didn't feel like it... It was there for story purposes. It didn't feel like it was necessary for gameplay reasons.
I agree. And at first, I didn't really realize the significance of that. And so I was using Sophie to make everything. And then when I got to a point where I needed a recipe from Plakta, I was like, oh, like her level was so low. And I was like, oh, no. So then I just had to like use Plakta like for a while. So that was a mistake on my part. But yeah, it didn't really feel like it needed to be that way. They just kind of put that in for the story, like you said.
And yeah, the way that grid system works, and I feel like I only got the greater concept, you know, look at the right, and yeah, you want to fill up the elements because that's how you'll get the traits, like, so you have heaps of fire, it'll give you, I mean, I'm probably associating the wrong element, but you know, it could be defense up will go from like small to large or something, so I was really trying to like perfect the grid to maximize that when I saw, oh, this is how I can actually make my equipment better. And then they add the catalyst system, which is it affects the grid in different ways. So it might block off certain parts of the grid you can't use, but that makes things more effective, like the element amounts. I only used a couple of them because I think most of them, because that you find them in treasure chests and stuff. But I think that was also very interesting. For me, I don't go too hard into this system. I pretty much just try to make what I can to get through the game. I'm not quite the brains to come up with the broken items like other people can, but I'm sure like all of that would be really good for the people that are into it.
Yeah, definitely. I thought it was fun to have like a little bit of a challenge, like with some of the restricted panels that blocked off a few spots. So you had to fit like your ingredients in a smaller space. That part was fun, but yeah, I'm kind of with you in the same boat as far as like, I mainly just crafted what I needed to progress. But I did see, I was looking as I played the game online just to see other people's thoughts. And like, they were like, yeah, I've already maxed out like the quality on like all of this. It was like this absurdly high number. And I'm like, wow, like there are some like hardcore fans getting into this and that's cool. So it sounds like they were able to mix up the system a little bit just to kind of like add a little extra challenge in there.
So the best way to play an Atelier game is to wait for the game facts on what items to make it your level. Yeah, that's one
that's
thing
right.
I found really, I think, annoying about the recipe unlock was that I didn't know where some ingredients were because I was playing pre-release, and I'm just like, is it just something like, you know, I need to increase the quality of my gathering items or something, because that also affects what you can and cannot pick up. Because you'll see that there's something else mysterious, but you can't, you know, you can't get it yet. It won't let you. Because there was armor and weapons that I couldn't make because I just didn't have whatever this ingredient was. Even like the level before that. And I was just like, where is it?
Yeah.
I haven't updated his swords for like, since everyone else has got the better stuff and he doesn't.
Oh my gosh, it is so comforting to hear you say that, because I had like the same like dilemma while I was playing. I'm like, everybody's upgraded but this guy, like I can't make his gun, like what am I gonna do? And it was hard, especially at the end. Like I really had to work to get the tools upgraded, because some of the tools, like if you didn't have them at their very best and max out like a specific trait, you couldn't get ingredients that you needed for certain recipes. And so that was just like such an ordeal all the way up to the end. And I think by the end I was just kind of like, okay, I'm ready to like have everything. I don't want to do this, like I'm ready to just have all of the items that I need.
And then you've also got, I didn't really use it that much, but you've got the adventuring tools. The one thing I had to remember to upgrade is, if this one has it, like the one that increases your speed, because obviously without the mount it's a bit more of a issue. But a lot of those are just passive benefits. And with the fast travel, I like never use the tent, because in these dungeon areas or just open areas there'd be like little campfires, and if you had a tent you could just rest up and recover like your health and skill points and all that. But because I can pretty much run straight back to my atelier, save and come back, and it's not much trouble to walk to the next part, I didn't really use it.
Yeah, I didn't either. I think if they had given the option to save at the tents, it would have been more appealing. But yeah, keeping that kind of like right in the atelier, and that's like the only place. Yeah, there was really no reason. The fast travel was great, though. It made things a lot more convenient as you explored.
I unlock a new fast travel point, or I'm about to go through a door, and I go back to the atelier and I save, because I don't know, it might be a boss immediately right in there or something.
Right, or you may have to fight them twice. You just don't know.
Oh, yeah. I'll be like, oh, I'm exploring a new area, and then like a boss showed up and I got handed to pretty hard because I wasn't expecting it.
As an avid MMO player, the true endgame isn't actually transmog or glamour, but in fact, it's collecting those elusive mounts and showing them off to your friends. Much like real life, though, you won't be mounting anything without taking the proper steps. Fortunately, the Thirsty Mage is partnering with Manscaped.com, the best in men's below-the-waist grooming, to provide mage listeners with 20% discount and free shipping on their products, which will ensure you can ride for hours. Just use the promo code THEMAGE, and you can get 20% off Manscaped.com's precision-engineered tools to keep your big love rocket airborne and ready for action. The hosts here at The Mage got a chance to try out the performance package for ourselves thanks to our friends at Manscaped.com. The package came with the Lawnmower 4.0 trimmer, the Weed Whacker ear and nose trimmer, Crop Preserver ball deodorant, Crop Reviver toner, and a pair of performance briefs and a travel bag to hold it all. Jordan, you recently tried out the performance package for yourself, and you've been using their package for a while now. Which one do you think you like the most now?
Yeah, it's funny. Like, this was totally unplanned, or like I knew we were doing the recording today. I actually did use the Lawnmower 4.0 trimmer this morning, and yeah, it's just super reliable. I was worried, like I had it not charging. I had it just sitting in the travel bag because I'd taken it with me on an outing about a month ago, and I thought, oh, okay, I might not have a lot of battery there. Might need to be charged first. Nope, still good to go. So battery life's obviously pretty good on it. And yeah, it's just really clean and easy to use. Like, it's sleek, it's easy to hold. You know, we love that flashlight on it. You know, even if you're shaving and it's daytime where there's light, you could always use a little bit of extra light because you want that precision, right? You want to, mm-hmm. you know, be as clean and shiny as you can. But yeah, I love the trimmer. You know, I'm going to keep using it. I like how it's got two kind of adjustable clips that you put on it, depending on how long you want to, or how much trimming you want to do, I guess. But yeah,
I'm a bare bones kind of guy myself.
That's as far as you can go, right? Yeah. Something, I guess, what sticks out to me after using it for a couple months now is that I haven't cut or nicked myself. And I think that's something you worry about, right? Like, when you're trimming down there, mm-hmm. like, you know, very sensitive area, you don't want any cuts or scrapes or anything, because you're really going to feel them. But yeah, no nicks or cuts so far. And so that's been pretty good. But yeah, Lawnmower 4.0 trimmer, definitely probably my favorite part of the package. And obviously it's the big feature of the Manscaped package, the performance package that we got. So yeah, happy to keep using it.
Yeah, I would have to agree with you on that. The lawnmower is really great. And as I sort of said, I was using real primitive pieces of equipment from a while ago. So definitely happy to be working with Manscaped.com. You can help support the Thirsty Mage and continue to see your mount number climb by using the promo code THEMAGE. That's THEMAGE, The Mage. Unlock your confidence and always use the right tools for the job with Manscaped.
Yeah, combat-wise, this entry has gone to back to turn-based because the Atelier Riser 2 at least was sort of, I guess, turn-based, but it was like on a timer, like an active timer. Whereas this one, you don't have to fret about doing your turn fast enough. You can just, you know, think through it. There is a timeline in terms of character turn order, and certain skills you use will like apply several times, but I didn't mind the going back to turn based because yeah, I could take my time or I could go really fast. I didn't have to wait for the little bar to come up for me to take my next turn. I could just, as fast as I can click it, that's when I can do it.
Yeah, I really liked Riser 2's combat, like I guess the hybrid version, but I enjoyed Sophie 2's combat much more. Because it was turn-based, but I still feel like there was a lot of cool, like, visual elements too. Like, you could do the support guard, I think, where you can switch out your characters and, like, they have a cool little animation where they block the attack. And the special, like, dual trigger attacks where they do this, like, super over-the-top animation and it's either, like, a really good attack or it's a really good buff. Those are fun. But, yeah, I really enjoyed the combat system. I think it had a lot going on as far as, like, what you could do. You could, like, attack, use special abilities, items. But when you got to the harder boss fights, like, you really needed all that stuff. I don't think there was an element in combat that I didn't use. when those harder fights happened.
And that's, you know, part of it is, like, you need to, like, definitely level, but the main thing is the alchemy. Like, if your items and armor and equipment is not up to snuff, you're just going to get stomped on and have to retreat back. But I definitely, yeah, I really liked the systems they put in place for this one, because your whole party was useful. Like, you didn't have favored members, and then, you have three people, because there's six party members, and you'd have three in the front and three in the back, and with those, when you do those dual skills or those support guards, then that would swap the character to the front. So everybody was getting used, and it felt really good to actually use the entire party, like they're all important and part of it.
Yeah, and they all sort of had their own special role, like, within the party, but they all still felt like you needed them all. Like, you had, like, your tank, like, I think is Diebold? I think I'm saying his name right. They had some interesting names in this game. But he was able to take a lot of damage, and he had a really high defense. And then you had Oleus, who, like, could deal a lot of damage. So everyone had, like, their own role, and it was cool to get to use them all. Nobody felt like an afterthought.
Yeah, and, like, the alchemist can use more items. Like, I didn't quite understand, like, you know, the restrictions, because it was like, I feel like Diebold could barely hold anything, like, a lot of things. I was like, no, he can't hold that for some reason. He can just have, like, some cream. That's there you go.
Yeah, he had, like, one, and his, like, item number was maxed out, because they all had, like, an item quality total or something.
Oh, and that's why.
Yeah, I didn't understand it either.
I had no idea. I knew it was like, oh, the alchemist could carry more. Like, people would have a certain, like, how many. But, like, it would just be like, you know, you can't carry this item. And I'm like, why? Why can't they?
Yeah, I noticed it eventually, not right away.
I didn't know there was a, like, number.
That's the thing with these games, though, I think. Like, there's so many things going on and so many tutorials that, like, some things like that, like, just don't get explained. And it's kind of like you're thrown in and you have to learn it yourself. But there was basically a number on the side with a lot of their stats that showed. And, like, Plakta and Sophie had a super high number, so they could carry, like, a ton of items, whereas, like, everyone else could only carry a few. And I guess every item was assigned, like, a number. So, like, when you tried to give Diebold, like, two things, he was like, no, I can't do it.
No. So that was kind of sad. Like, I understood, like, alchemists could have more just because I figured, you know, maybe certain items are exclusive to them. But, yeah, I didn't realize it was just that.
Yeah, it makes sense, I guess, in that way, too.
But, yeah, and then all the party members are, like, they've got their associated element, because you've got, like, that level of weakness, or Alette has the, like, a damage over time attack, which was really good, especially with the, I can't remember much about, like, in terms of combat in Ryza, whether they had, like, the auras you had to break or not. Like,
I don't think they had auras, if I remember it right, but because I don't recall that, but yeah, the aura was a huge deal. And Sophie too, yeah.
Yeah, because it's basically blocking almost all of your damage until you can break it down. And normally the way to break it down would be items or skills would take at least one damage to the aura, maybe two or so if it was, like, particularly effective. So it's like you're having to go all out just to knock down the aura so you can actually attack their health.
Yeah, and I was impressed at the variety of auras that were in this game, as far as what exactly they did.
Physical or different elements, like, whatever they were weak to, they were like, no, you can't touch me with that now.
Yeah, and I think one of them, it was even like, it was weak to, like, debuffs. So, like, that's a very specific thing. Like, it's not just even, like, a specific element. It's like, no, it's an ability that would, like, debuff them in some way. So that was cool. I feel like it made you really think, because you're like, oh, I can't use this character right now because their attacks or this element, they're not going to be able to do anything, or I'll have to use a skill of theirs that isn't like this element. So it did kind of put a lot of thought into what you had to do.
Like, it definitely makes people, you know, to play these games, you've got to take full advantage of everything that's available to you. because they do seem cutesy, and they are like nice and pretty lighthearted, but you've definitely you got to put effort into it. You can't just breeze through it. Like I said, you've got to do the alchemy or you're not going to get anywhere.
Yeah, I think they can be a little bit misleading if you don't know about the Atelier series. I know when I played Ryza 2 last year, it was a kind of a big shock at first. Like, oh wow, there is a lot to do in this game. And yeah, a lot of it is like really necessary. But when you see like the trailers and everything, it just looks like this beautiful game and like these cute characters, and they're just running around and collecting items. Like, you just don't get like that full picture. Like, okay, I'm really going to have to learn these systems to progress.
Yeah. It's definitely not a first timer's RPG.
No.
You've got to at least played maybe something else, the way you can get the grasp of the combat system, and then come back and realize you've got this entire other thing going on.
That's a good point. And it makes me wonder, what is a good starting RPG? Because yeah, the Atelier series is probably not it.
Well, we've done an episode on that a little while back where we talked about which ones we thought were good, especially because I'd sort of like, you know, I'd played like Pokemon and stuff, but I hadn't really been into RPGs until like a few, you know, quite recently, like a few years ago. So I talked about what ones helped me appreciate turn-based combat and like the different systems, but definitely not Atelier.
Yeah, it is not for first-timers. You've got to try something else, but they are fun. Like, once you kind of have gotten into the genre a little bit, they are really fun, and they're actually great because I feel like they're a good length. I don't ever feel like they feel too long.
They're a lot. I mean, the latest games have been slightly longer, but they're definitely a lot shorter than the average RPG.
Right. Like, if you can complete it in, like, 45 hours, that's really not bad comparatively to a lot of other RPGs out there.
Yeah, and then it depends, I guess, whether or not you're willing to look at guides or not, or how much time you're spending in photo mode. But yeah, like, the newer ones can take about, 30 or so hours, whereas I think some of the older ones were, like, less than 20. Although I guess the older ones also had a time limit, so.
Oh, that's right. I do feel like I've seen that, where, you only had a certain amount of time, you better make the most of it.
I've only played one game with the time limit system, which was Atelier Asia, and I found it wasn't actually that difficult. Obviously you couldn't do, like, there's a lot of optional bosses post game kind of stuff. I'd have to be a bit more focused if I wanted to get all that done in one playthrough, but that game, I wasted an entire like 9 months of the game because I was going to the wrong spot, and I still managed to beat it with a few months to spare. So
oh wow.
I'm not sure, so maybe some of the older ones, the time might be, like, you do have to be conscious of it, but there's also not necessarily a reason to be afraid of the ones that do have a time system, because some of them you'd have to be trying really bad to mess it up, to fail.
Yeah, there's a lot of wiggle room if you need it, it sounds like.
Yeah. And yes, that's what you're talking about here, where it's like these games look really pretty and they've got a generally wholesome vibe because the director said, like, the tone of the series isn't, you know, there's usually like maybe something dramatic or something he's protecting, but it's not usually like, not usually the fate of the world. It's often more personal story that's going on. But then the gameplay is a bit more hardcore than you'd think.
Yeah,
like, I don't think they're hard, but you need to make use of what you have.
Yeah, and just be ready to really read those tutorials and know that, like, there will be some trial and error involved, but you'll get it. Just maybe not all right at the beginning of the game. I've talked to a few people who've played the series, and it makes me feel better to know that, like, if you don't figure out a system until like halfway through the game, it's okay. Yeah. Because it happens. It's really hard to like master everything right away, unless you're like an Atelier pro and like you played all the games.
Yeah, and then even then, when there's new stuff, they change it up, so they've got to figure it out too.
Yeah, they like to keep players on their toes, it seems.
And story-wise, the thing that's... Oh, wait, no. Sorry, there's something in combat I've completely forgotten I want to get to. The items, because in Italia Raza, it was like... There was like a weird system with the core crystals or something where like the item, yeah, like the item use. Whereas this one, the items are items and you use them, they're gone, but items can hold multiple uses. And if you can, you know, you could run out of like to zero, but it wouldn't like vanish into smoke. And with Pirka, she's from. She can duplicate items. You have like an auto restock system. So you just come back to your atelier and you get the bill and she's like, and you're like, oh no, this is what I get for having these, like everyone holding high quality Draco bombs. There goes my money. Not that I usually had too much trouble with money, but I wanted to do something big and new. I was like, oh no. But I really like that system of items because they still felt more like the other games where it's, you know, you use it up, you use it up, but you're also not losing it.
Yeah, definitely. And it just felt really user friendly. Mm. Like you didn't have to worry about having to like recraft something. Mm. And you also like in crafting, it was nice because in some items you had control over how many uses, like you could,
yes,
you had an option
with the traits, like when, because you know different ingredients have the different traits and then you're putting that in the grid together to try and unlock them, so you could there'd be, yeah, just uses the number, or there'd be certain trait where it'd be like the uses is decreased, but the effectiveness is increased, or the other way around, or when it's on its last use, it is 50% more effective.
Yeah, so I'm glad that they gave like players agency there. They could, and there was a little bit more strategy involved too. Like you could think like, okay, with this item, is it going to be more useful to me if I have more uses of it, or is it better to make it more powerful so I can just get out of combat quickly? And that was neat. Yeah,
the customization of the series is like a big thing. Like you can, like when I was up against a certain boss, I went back and I was doing their equipment and I was like, oh, this, like these dragon materials increase like how much damage I can do to the aura, so I like shoved that on everyone's weapons just so I could like shred the aura faster. And that's, yeah, you can customize things to, you know, like you might have to go back and get some ingredients, but you can really customize things to your specific need. And then often, you know, for a boss, if I didn't like get it first try, which I don't think I had for any of them, to be honest, maybe one of them, but you know, you go back and you make the right items and you get the right traits you want to face that fight, and then you take it down. And with the, when you go to Pika's Emporium, you can also just get it to duplicate stuff you've crafted. So if you make one good bomb, instead of wasting all your ingredients, like if you want to give multiple people that bomb, instead of wasting your ingredients, you just go to her store, pay money, and then you can copy what you've made, you know, five times and hand them off to everyone that can hold them except for Diebold.
Right, poor Diebold. Oh my gosh, that was so helpful. Pirka and her Emporium, like that was probably one of the most helpful things in this game. Just being able to duplicate an item so you didn't have to craft it twice, or replace items so you didn't have to recraft them again. Even though sometimes that would result in sticker shock, it was worth it every time. It was so worth it. Even towards the end of the game, we're like, you were using really high quality items and they cost a lot of money. But with as much as this game has going on, there were some really good ways that the devs like put in to keep it from being like too much.
Yeah.
To where you'd have to kind of monitor your inventory so much. Like there were a few things like that that made it less of a chore.
Yeah.
Which I appreciated so much.
And then I feel like, yeah, I guess I compare it a lot to Raza 2, but that's just because it's like the latest entry in the series. I felt like we're a lot, like there was still like the couple shop characters that we talked to, but like the shops were less like varied, they were a bit smaller. in comparison. Like, it was like, you know, that wasn't the focus of the story. Like, it wasn't about being part of the city. It was about, you know, the adventure through the world. But they, you know, they're still like the shop. Sometimes you can, because I couldn't figure out where to get milk for a while. So it's just like, come on, shop, restock the milk. I need it.
I had a hard time finding the milk too. I don't know if other people have had that problem, but yeah, it was like, just fingers crossed. I hope this vendor has it. Like, because I don't know. Because
I can't remember what it's from, but like, normally liquid, you're like, okay, a barrel or a pot or something, whereas like milk was something else. And I was like, well, how was I supposed to know that?
I think I just ended up buying it at one of the stores. Yeah. Because I was like, I don't know where to find this, so we'll just buy it.
Yeah, so sometimes you can buy stuff to save yourself the trouble, or yeah, you can sell things. I didn't really sell too much in this one. I think in, you know, like, Rise of Two, I got, like, you know, benefits to selling, because it would, like, increase, like, people's stock in the other stores. But whereas this one, I didn't, you didn't have a bunch of, those complicated systems in regard to the shops and stuff. So I didn't sell as much. I mostly just did the requests, like, just loaded them up and whacked the mini bosses and stuff. I actually found, because eventually you unlock like the EX bosses, like the ones that are supposed to be pretty tough, and I go to them and I was like, they're not that tough. They're slightly stronger than the average little mini bosses that are on the map, but they're, most of them aren't that bad once you've unlocked them.
No, they really weren't. I feel like the story bosses were the ones that really would get you. And so after you fought them, like, because there were some hard story bosses before the EX ones unlocked. And it's like, after you fight one of those, the EX bosses did not feel that bad. I was like, oh, okay, I'm doing fine. Like, this is okay. Yeah, they weren't so bad. But the requests I thought were fun, though. I mean, they were all just like normal side quests, but it was nice to have like a steady stream of money coming from those, because you really did have to kind of manage your money if you were getting your items duplicated and restocked so much.
Yeah, so I definitely just always loaded up on those, and then when you're exploring, it'll sort of let you know when you've picked up something towards one of those goals. And some of the requests, because one of the, back to story-wise, one of the main things is like talking to your friends. Like, there's a lot of, like, there's the main cutscenes, but there's a lot of just little cutscenes. So you might finish a story beat and then you've got about like 10 of those to go through, where you're catching up and progressing like the individual stories of your party members, your other friends in town, just little things like that, where they're all pretty, I mean, they're all pretty, like, just, you know, nice, relaxing, sometimes funny. But yeah, eventually you might unlock a request from a character, and then fulfilling that will give you something else.
Yeah, it all kind of flowed together throughout the story as you made progress. Speaking of the cast and like their just their different requests and everything, how did you just feel about the characters in general?
I liked all the party members. Yeah, I did find Alette's outfit to be interesting. That's
yeah, same.
Like, I was just like, this is an interesting jester costume. Like, it's really, like I said, I think in my preview, that she needs to go to the fashion police. But
wow.
Yeah. You know, it's usually like girls are pretty well designed or over designed, and then the boys are very plain looking. Dobel's in a knight outfit, and Oleus is like got a waistcoat and his gun. I think his main feature is like his hair color.
Yeah, he did have a nice hairstyle, at least. It was better than Diebold's. He kind of had that, like, bowl cut going on. I don't know why. But, yeah, I liked them all. I do think, like, the Atelier games have fun characters. Like, most of them are, like, kind of goofy in their own way, but they're fun.
They do a good job of, like, you know, making the characters have a dynamic together for funny scenes, and I do usually like all of them. I haven't, you know, I don't often have a party member I'm like, I don't like you, I don't want you here.
Yeah, it was fun to see them all interact with each other as the story went on, especially like I think Oleus and the Let had kind of a fun dynamic, and he had a funny one with Diebold as well, because like their personalities were so different.
And yeah, one of the things story wise were, I'm gonna say it's minor spoilers, except also if you have, you know, maybe play a little bit of the first game or something, they really hint towards it a lot, but then it takes a long time in the story for them, the two characters, to actually acknowledge it. They just sort of ignore it. But that's with one of your party members, Ramziel, and like, you know, like you've written that the premise of it's interesting because the world they're in is like people from different places and times. So some people are from like away in the past, or maybe even in the future from where Sophie is at.
Yeah, that was probably my favorite part of the story with this game. And yeah, I think it's tough because like it is kind of a little bit of a reveal when you find out who Ramziel is, but if you have played the first game and have some of that knowledge, you kind of already know. But I thought it was cool because you even got references about, I think from Pyrka with Diebold as well. Like she kind of knew the time period that he was from. And it was fun to see Sophie and Ramziel just like try to deal with the awkward situation that they were in because they are connected, but it's just different for both of them because it's not the relationship that either one of them like had previously.
Well, you know, one of the, like I said, with a different time, some people didn't even know each other at that.
Right. You know, exactly. Like yeah.
I think on Ramziel's end, that's more, I find that would be more shocking than the other way around, you know?
Oh yeah. She was like, wait, what? I have a family? Like, what is happening? Like, yeah.
She's like, I'm not even married yet. What?
She's like, wait a minute. No. Yeah. But her reaction was so, like, accurate and funny. Because, like, of course, like, if you met, like, your granddaughter and you were still in your 20s, like, how would you react? Like, wait a minute. Like, I'm not ready for this yet.
Yeah.
But I thought it was really sweet because if you play the first game or even just kind of read a little bit about it, you know that Sophie and her grandmother were really close, and she has this opportunity to see her again. And I just kind of, when I was like playing through the game, I'm just like, wow, like, I feel like all of us would love a chance to see a loved one again that we hadn't seen in a while, you know? That was just a really cool concept.
I did think it was interesting how long it took to get to that point, especially they both got the same necklace.
And oh, yeah.
None of them said anything, as far as I'm aware. None of them, like, not even when they come to this realization. I don't think they still mention it at all that I know of. And it's like, really? That would have been the first thing. I would have been like, oh. If I saw, you know.
Yeah, like, something is the same here. What is happening? Yeah, so it was fun, though.
So the story focus of this one is, like, people's personal dreams, because that's what the world is, a place where people from different times and places can focus on their personal dreams and then come back to where they belong, like, once they've got the skills to actually do that. Like, Alette wants to be super merchant, and I won't spoil like why she wants that, but you know, she's a merchant, she's practicing her craft, trying to make it the best, trying to save a bunch of money, whereas some other people have lost their dream, like they're not quite sure what they want anymore, and they might have been here for a lot longer because they're a bit lost. So it's a very, I feel like, you know, like these games range, I guess, in how deep into things they go, but it is definitely like a really interesting topic where you've got the different range of people that are there fulfilling their dreams and other people that are just stuck there because they don't know what to do anymore.
Yeah, and it was good to see it like not always put in a super positive light. Like for Alette, like, of course, like, she wants to hone her skills, and so many other people in that world were there because they wanted to hone their skills and then go back. But yeah, you kind of heard some like tough stuff from some of the characters too, where like they didn't really have a direction, or they had failed and they weren't really sure how to rectify it, like within themselves. Because like with Atelier Games, so much of the story is like upbeat and happy and, you know, they're wholesome, like they're just fun. But I think that it kind of still made all the characters a bit more relatable. Like they all had their own different motivations. And so you were bound to connect with at least one of them based on their reasons why they were in this world. And so it was cool that they kind of went through the whole spectrum of reasons.
Whereas Sophie's just there because she got sucked in.
Yeah. But she is kind of there. I mean, she helps everyone there, which is cool.
Well, like, and it helps her, you know, in a way. She's prepping for her alchemy exam with all the new different alchemy there is.
Right. Everybody wins by the end of it. Like, they all get a good experience. But I don't know. I thought it was done pretty well. It's definitely a JRPG type of story, but it is relatable in some ways too, because we all have dreams, and just having a concept of a world where you could live them out for a little while is pretty neat.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like, the story's never been, you know, especially the main plots, you know, are never like overly groundbreaking, but they're definitely human. Like in one of the games, like the first one I played was Taliesha. It was pretty much just a damsel in distress situation. But I was very motivated. Like, that was a really big motivator for me to, like, save her sister, try to find her. And so I think this, the stories are worth going through because of, you know, there's still that human connection.
Yeah, there's a piece of it that you can relate to on a personal level, and that keeps you invested.
So was there anything else in particular about the game we haven't mentioned that you want to talk about?
Let me think. I'm like, we have really talked about it, like, from top to bottom of the barrel.
I was just making sure, I'm like, because I was going part way through, and I'm like, oh, I forgot to talk about the items, and I forgot to talk. So I'm just like, talked about gathering, the synthesis, the alchemy, the different exploration, Sophie's story. Story, there we go. So
yeah,
overall, what were your thoughts on this game?
Overall, I really enjoyed it. I do think that I have to kind of be in a certain mood to play Atelier games, because they require a lot of you when you play. But I had a great time. I think I enjoyed it a little bit more than Ryza 2 because I understood what I was doing more.
Yeah.
So it was fun. And honestly, the part that I liked the most was just the story with her and Ramsiel and that whole connection. That really resonated with me. And it was really sweet. So overall, I enjoyed it. And it was a fun time. But I'm going to need a break before I play another Atelier game for a little while.
That's like, you go, oh, well, at least I'll go for a year, but then there'll be another one out, and you're like, oh, I'm never going to catch up with these games.
I'll never catch up, but that's all right. They're still fun, and I'm looking forward to seeing what they do, because I think this year is the 25th anniversary of the series, so I'm sure they've got other stuff planned.
Yeah, like, they've done spin-offs and stuff too. Like, I haven't played it, but there's one that's like more of a town building game or something, you know. So
that's interesting. That would be really different.
It's like a sort of an all-stars thing, because you get characters from the other games coming in, like, they're not the main character, but it's just, I think that was like a celebration type game.
So they could have something like special and different for this too. That's cool. Yeah,
maybe.
How did you feel about this one overall?
I really liked it. Like I said, and I think the only things that bothered me was like the alchemy system at first. Like, I was doing the auto system, but then eventually I got used to it and was really into it. At some point I'll go and play the first Sophie, but I definitely prefer this one over it. especially with like, yeah, just all the up that, you know, one, the leveling seems a bit more normal. And yeah, I did think it was interesting though, because yeah, the max level from Sophie, that's what she starts as in this game. So I thought that was a nice touch. And I did review it for RPG Site, and compared to like for my own channel when I did Riser 2, I did rate it just a little bit less than Riser 2, because I felt like Riser 2 had like the alchemy system, it had a lot going on with the swimming, the mounts, the whole system in place with the town people, like all the requests and leveling up merchants, things like that. It was just like a little bit more, but I still rate this one as really good, and I really liked it.
Good. Yeah. I feel like they both, like Sophie 2 and Riser 2, like they both do a lot well. And then there's just a few things that are just like, that could be a little bit better. But overall, they're both fun. And I think they change up the series enough to kind of keep you on your toes while you play.
And yeah, so I would say yes. Atelier isn't a good entry point if you haven't, like, and you tell you it's not a good entry point if you haven't played RPGs before. But these, you know, even though they've got number two in them, they're not bad places to start either for the actual series itself.
Right. They are okay. Take it from someone who has started with two sequels in this series. The game does a lot to help you kind of adjust and jump in. But I know also that, you know, some players really like to play things in order, so that's cool too. But you don't have to with these. It's not a super necessary thing.
That's what I mean. Or you can just pick like one trilogy to start on and go for that, because like I said, they pretty much seem to be in their own world, so you're not gonna miss out on something in Riser games if you haven't played the Dusk trilogy, you know?
Right, and there's so many to choose from, so you know, you have a lot of options out there.
Yeah. My probably recommending starting point for new people would probably be the first Riser game, but I have one major issue with that, which is how slow the start of the game is. Like, it took me almost half the game before I finally, you know, got to like nearly like a boss point, and then after that the story flowed on well, but it was just like the start of that one is really slow for some reason.
Yeah, I feel like I've heard that just in general from folks who have played it, that it is good once you get to that point, but you kind of have to have some patience with it at the beginning. So yeah, I can see why that would be a good starting point, but also just like, you know, be prepared for that if you're gonna play that one first.
This is the last call for alcohol this evening. Drink up, drink up, drink up, and order again. This is the last call for alcohol, get going.
Yeah, so normally, sometimes, I think we haven't done it too much lately, but sometimes we do a last call, which is like a mini topic that we talk about. And since this game is one, obviously we're not talking about the Atelier series in this sense, but, you know, a lot of games nowadays have crafting, especially I feel like in the genre I don't really play, but they seemed like, you know, a few years ago now, but there was a trend of like adding crafting to all those action adventure type, you know, like third person perspective games. They didn't really have crafting, and then they've added it into their series. And so do you think, to like outside of games where it's the purpose, such as Atelier or certain like roguelites or something, do you think too many games have crafting systems now?
I think too many games like try to put in a crafting system that is either too involved for what it needs to be, or I guess it feels like it's just tacked on. I think when you have crafting, it needs to be something that feels like it makes sense.
Yeah.
You know, like it doesn't just need to be this like thing that's like, oh, well, you know, you can do this if you want. But yeah, that's a cool question, because I do feel like sometimes you'll get into a game and then there's a crafting system in there and you're just like, why is this here? And you never use it. And it's just very weird.
Yeah, because for games like, you know, where it's built in like Atelier or like Minecraft, things like that, where it's major part of the game, that's fine. But yeah, I found a lot of games just have it, and it's like if they're from a series that didn't previously have it, or it's just what's the point of this? Like, maybe I'd rather just find better items in a chest somewhere or grab it off an enemy than having to pick up leaves while I'm also shooting around, you know?
Right. Like, it's just, there's already enough going on that I guess would supply the gameplay aspect of it, right? Like, I'm already doing this combat. I'm already having to explore or do puzzles. I don't need this other system. Because sometimes a game can have too many systems.
Yeah.
And it just feels overwhelming and too much. So I definitely think that can be a problem. I'm trying to think of some examples of games where it kind of felt not super necessary. So I'm just trying to think to see.
I was like I said, a lot of them, like, I heard the complaints about, and not once I necessarily played, but I'm pretty sure, I'm not, you have to maybe correct me, but I was saying, like, certain games, like, I think maybe some of, like, the newer Tomb Raiders had added crafting. I'm not 100% sure on that. But some series like that, they went from no crafting to having it. And I was going to say, double check before I run my mouth too much. But, you know, things like that where it was, like, a sudden change. Or just, yeah, certain genres where you're like, why is this even in here? Like, what's it got to do? I'd often, so they added, I don't know if it's been in the older games or not. It's definitely in the newer games, though.
Yeah, that is interesting. That's not a game series that I would have expected to have crafting. It just doesn't feel like it would fit there. But yeah, that's the thing. It's like, there's just some games where it just doesn't feel like it would really fit. Like, especially like an action adventure game like that.
Yeah.
It just feels weird. And also, I think that some games take crafting like a little too far, like, and they make it like really, really complicated. I know I remember hearing some complaints about like the last Story of Seasons game where you have to get all of these different machines. The makers, that's what it is. I've not played that game, but I remember seeing screenshots farms.
My pile, and then it's tanking, and then it's tanking your frame rate too, because you just got 100 of them. What was worse than when that originally launched was like, it could only produce like one or so things at a time, so you would have multiple of the same one just because they weren't effective.
Why?
Yeah, like, and then that kind of series, it's like, they added crafting, because I guess you know, they want to take inspiration from stuff like Stardew and stuff, but they sort of missed the point, because normally there are, like, not quite crafting, but there's things in some games where it's like, you collect the materials, like, so in these games you collect the lumber and the stone and then send it off to somebody to make the building for you. So I'd probably prefer, you know, just a simpler focus like that, where it's maybe you collect things naturally, but you put it through, it totals up and then you put it through someone else. And yeah, I think the makers were previously just something you'd buy and not have to go through crafting. And yeah, there was just too many of them.
I remember seeing like screenshots from people that had like just this huge space of land, and all it was were those makers, and I'm just like, wow, that's a lot. Like, I don't know what's going on here. But yeah, I think crafting is one of those things that it requires more thought to make it really good than I think a lot of devs really think about. Like, they're like, oh, let's add crafting. But it really is a system that I think you should think about and really make it either like useful or necessary or fun, or else players may just not want to engage with it at all.
But yeah, definitely. I think Pioneers of Old Town is a good example of it just feeling pretty tacked on.
And yeah,
not being thought out well at all.
Right, and if it's causing even performance issues, then you know it's a real problem.
Yeah,
because that's just not, you don't want that if you can avoid it.
But yeah, like, yeah, some it fits, and other times it's like, you should have just left it alone. Especially I don't understand it in a lot of those action adventure games. It's just like, let's stop doing that and let's add a bunch of RPG mechanics and crafting into it for some reason.
Yeah, well, and I think it kind of went along with the trend that happened a few years ago where like everything had to be open world. Like, and it just felt like, oh, every like big game needs to have an open world or like a sandbox style world, and you could gather ingredients and like do a crafting system on the side, where really like some games really do benefit from that type of design, but not every game has to have that. And I think we're past that point now, like where you don't see that all the time, but I think that may have contributed to it as well, because it seemed like so many games were taking that approach.
Yeah. Well, thanks for joining me to talk about Atelier Sophie 2. Do you have anything that you've recently worked on or are going to promote? Because you write
Yeah, of course. I write for Nintendo Force, which is a magazine that releases every 2 months that covers all sorts of Nintendo topics and games. And right now, we're working on our May and June issue, which will come out at the start of May. So we're working on that. And if you are interested in that, we do have a Patreon. It's patreon.com/NintendoForce. And you can just get some more info on what we do there. But yeah, we're working on it. It's going to be a sports-themed issue because of the new Mario Strikers Battle League game that's coming out in May.
Mm. And your Twitter handle is AvengerMax.
Yes, that's right.
That's where they can find you.
That's where you can find me and see way too many tweets about Trails. So click on it at your own risk.
I don't think I have, well, I'm working on stuff, but I don't think I have anything to talk about right now. I'm not even sure when this episode's going to be, if it's going to be placed soon or before some other ones, so I can't even say what might be next week, because I don't know when this is airing. But nevertheless, thanks for joining us, and I hope to see you on the podcast some other time.
Awesome. Thank you so much for having me. I had a great time.
That's it. Bye, everyone.
Bye.